Unfortunately, I resisted the temptation to give a consistent, systematic thought. I, much more humbly, I would like to limit myself just to do some comments on what was previously said and maybe help to or try to clarify some points. First, about the real, a couple of improvisations first. As it was already noted, what we all share is the idea that the Lacanian real has to be, in a way, desubstantialized, freed of this postmodern topic of the real out there, too strong to confront it directly, and, you know, we can just get partial views on it. If you permit me to repeat an old anecdote of mine, which is perfect for, to use just for, to this clarification. This is, for me, the best scientific story to illustrate what is the Lacanian real. You know, in Einstein's development of passage from a special to general theory of relativity, he totally turns around his notion of matter and how the space is curved. He begins by the idea that space is not curved symmetric, then matter curves the space. Like you have kind of a flat symmetrical space, empty space, matter comes, it curves the space. What he then does is something wonderful, I claim, deeply Hegelian. He turns it around. He says, no, it's not that matter intervenes and curves the space, but that all that, naively to put it, really is curved space. And matter, curved space, comes first. Matter is an effect of how we perceive curved space. And I think that if we apply this to Freud, we get in Freud also exactly the same shift in his notion of how to relate the symbolic order with the real of a trauma. First, Freud thought, in the same way as Einstein, it's a very broad parallel, okay, we have a non-curved, flat, symmetrical, whatever, symbolic space, then something happened. And I don't mean it in a tasteless way, like you are raped, you witness something horrible, whatever. And then, of course, your symbolic space gets curved because of this trauma, something cannot be spoken of, etc. The balance is lost. But then if you read closely Freud's seminar on Wolfsmann, you will see that he's not saying that, but exactly the opposite, in a very second stage Einstein way. For Freud, it's not that the child was doing okay, the small Wolfsmann, and then he saw that famous Atergo mother, no, as Freud makes it very clear, when the small Wolfsmann saw that Atergo coitus, it was not a trauma, it was just nothing. He just inscribed it as a neutral trace, he didn't know what to do with it. And then, later, at the age of when, 5, 6, when you start to, when you are perplexed by sexuality and the origin of children and all that stuff, then, in order to answer to the deadlock, symbolic deadlock of sexuality and so on, he pulled out and retroactively traumatized that experience. So, literally, again, you see the similarity. First, the discursive space was curved, and then something which was not a trauma was traumatized to function as the traumatic stuff of it, and so on. So again, this, I think, is what is crucial in the Lacanian notion of the real, that it's not about the real as something brutally intruding, and so on. It's the real as, like, the curvature of symbolic space, which, again, precedes its cause. Its cause is a retroactive projection and so on. Second point, what we just started with, Heidegger, Lacan, and so on. I would like to improvise some of my thoughts here. The first one would be that, again, what I already said, the big enigma is, my God, how is it that Lacan sticks to the notion of the subject? Of course, for Heideggerians, this means, Orthodox Heideggerians, this means, oh, you know the story, Lacan remains within the horizon of metaphysical nihilism, of subjectivity, whatever. But I think we can put it in another way. We should precisely link it to the question of philosophy, or rather, ontology. For Lacan, in a way, Heidegger remains too much of a philosopher, in spite of his Überwindung of Western metaphysics. For Lacan, we should take the term ontology literally, in the sense of bringing together ontic dimension, beings, and logos language. For Lacan, from the very beginning, didn't Parmenides say, his famous logos, legein, and being are the same? You have this correlation. And Lacan's point is precisely this gap. The gap between being and logos, for Lacan, the relationship is antagonistic, and where do we find it? You know Heidegger's well-known phrase of house designs, language is a house of being. Now, if I may be a little bit ironic, Lacan agrees with it, and he even says somewhere with a slight supplement that it's a torture house of being, you know, like that that Lacan emphasizes this painful, torturing dimension of radical incompatibility between the body of jouissance and logos and language. In this sense, I think that Lacan would have agreed what Heidegger says more or less about poetry, but would have added that isn't poetry, to put it at its most elementary way, a torturing of language? Just think about it, how much you have to torture words to write a good sonnet, you know, to cut words, to squeeze them, and so on. Or even further, not only logos, but take cinema, read Eisenstein theory, montage of attractions. It's basically, it reads like a torturer's manual, no? You cut, brutal cutting, bringing together. Now you will say, yeah, this is Einstein's violent subjectivity. Then you will say, what about those open Catholic authors, or not only Catholic, like from Bresson or André Bazin theory to Tarkovsky, which said precisely that the director should not intervene, you open yourself to it. My God, look at the beginning, first 7 minutes shot of Tarkovsky's last film, Sacrifice, and I claim it's just the opposite torturing. It's that, how do you call it, that Iron Maiden, which stretches you, no? So for me, a debate between Tarkovskyan and Eisensteinian is the debate of two torturers, no? One says, cut it, the other says, no, we rather stretch it, and so on. But I really mean it. I don't like Elfriede Jelinek too much. But here she was right when she said something which I think Lacan would have deeply agreed, but not Heidegger, that language at its basic dimension lies. It's a stupid lie. And that, as she said, we need to torture language to make him say the truth. Now, if you are a naive humanist leftist, you will say, oh, you begin torturing language, you will end up torturing people. I will say, no, it's exactly this is the choice we have. If you are not ready to torture language, you will start. And here we can see, so first, let me be very clear here. As Lacan makes it very clear when he speaks about the answer of the real and so on, for Lacan, subject at its most fundamental is not this neuzeitliche Subjektivität, manipulation and so on. It's precisely a suffering, that part of the real which suffers the effect of language. It's this fundamental passivity, and I think one can even show this materially. Apropos Antigone, Jean-Luc Nancy, no, sorry, it was the other guy, Philippe Lacoux-Labarthe, I think, who wrote a good text on Heidegger's reading of Antigone, claiming how Heidegger totally ignored this aspect of what Lacan later would have called suffering or between the two deaths. You know, where you are alive, not yet, between symbolic and real death. Or, to quote here, he's marvelous here. I love this apparently totally stupid clinical empirical remark, but which is much deeper and up to the point. François Balmès, one of, unfortunately he died, excellent writers who worked on Lacan, wrote a couple of introductory excellent essays. He says, apropos of Sein und Zeit, Heidegger's, again, a wonderful remark, which may sound stupid, but it's so accurate. It sounds simply, Heidegger would have said, idiot, doesn't understand anything. Balmès said that the problem with Heidegger is that his theory in Sein und Zeit works for neurotic but cannot cover psychotics, you know. And it's effectively true, because in neurosis, you are still within what Heidegger would have called this temporality of Dasein, future, past, and so on. What you get in psychosis is something which, and that's the traumatic paradox, you are, in a way, outside this human circle of, let's call it naively, normal functioning of language, how you are thrown into the world and so on, with all this temporality, you know, from the future to the past to the present and so on. But in a way, you are still within the human universe. You are outside, but inside outside. And I read in detail, trying to account for this, Heidegger's letters published, you know, with that, I forgot his name, that Swiss psychiatrist.
Medard Boss.
Medard Boss, yes. And Heidegger, effectively, he only comments cases where you can do a simple phenomenological analysis, reducing them to Sorge, to this care, engaged attitude. But what about the horror of the so-called, what Malabou called post-traumatic personalities, which, and this is, again, the mystery of so-called Muslimen, Muslims, about which Agamben talks. These are precisely, to put it in Heidegger's terms, human beings which are no longer Dasein in Heideggerian sense. You don't get this, you know, Entwurf, engagement, and so on. Why to keep for them the term subject? Because, now I will say something paradoxical. You know how the early Heidegger, at least, dismisses this modern subjectivity, claiming modern subjectivity, almost in a Marxist way, presupposes as if I am here, reality is there, I just passively observe it, but no, we are from the very beginning engaged in it, Entwurf, thrown into it, and so on. But I would say, what you can recognize in cases described by, not even psychiatry, by simply described in naive terms, of people who were so totally traumatized that their personality was erased and so on, what you find there is precisely this type of a subject. You are there, but you just witness reality, you are a living dead, you are not engaged in it. So Nancy focuses on this and makes a wonderful comment for how, no wonder that Heidegger made that tasteless remark about, you know, in concentration camps they were producing corpses the same way as, because for this terrifying position where you are a living dead, that is to say, still alive in a way you can speak, but not fully human in the sense of engaged, like again, Muslims, so-called from a concentration camp described by Agamben, for that there is no space in Heidegger. And if you don't believe me, again, look at those letters from Medard Boss, where Heidegger can deal just with these simple cases, you know, and basically Heidegger is answering Mederbos bullshit, no? Like, Mederbos presents him an example of, I don't know, a guy pathologically jealous, and then Heidegger writes back, interesting, let's see how being is disclosed to this person, and so on. It doesn't work. Okay, so you see, and here we come to cogito. The reason, as, again, Balmes developed so nicely, the reason after long flirting with Heidegger or with different subversions of the cogito, in his key, unpublished yet, seminar, I think it's 66, 67, I may be wrong, La Logique du Fantasme, Logic of the Fantasy, what Lacan does there is something very paradoxical. He finally, fully returns to cogito. You know how before he was playing all the possible games with it. First, this, instead of cogito ergo sum, he was first saying, I am not where I think. Okay, Lacan immediately saw that this is a very dangerous position. It can easily be turned into some kind of a Lebensphilosophy. My true being is not where I think, but is some shitty young Marxist, you know, productive engagement or whatever. Then, much more interestingly, Lacan turned it around. I think where I am not. This is already a more interesting idea, that the unconscious is not thought without being, because here you have all the Lebensphilosophy. It's not that the unconscious is not being outside thought, but thought outside being. Like, being is me as a concrete person, but there is another scene, not positively existing, virtual scene where I am thought. Then Lacan tried all other reversals, perversions, like cogito, 2 points, ergo sum, like I think and under quotation marks, I am. In other words, I only think that I am and all that. But finally, he does something in this seminar. He asserts cogito ergo sum, their identity, but again, as an empty identity. He claims that cogito ergo sum, before becoming res cogitans, is that unique point where I neither think nor am. I am not because I'm just that brief nobody without substance, and I don't think because it's just this purely tautological, I think I am, basically, so what, not, you know what I mean, no thought. And for, this is, I think, Lacan's genius, that this empty point of cogito is, again, neither onto nor logical. And as such, paradoxically, although it is totally empty, in the sense of cogito ergo sum, which means neither cogito nor sum, as such, it's also the place for what Lacan emphasizes, and you and Engber talking about this, of course, as this third space, which is neither onto nor logic, which is the real of jouissance, of enjoyment, and so on. And again, here we can, again, here I must again celebrate Lacula Barthes, who again links this very abstract topic of how Lacan reads Antigone, what he misses there, to the problem of Heidegger's, not blaming him cheaply, but nonetheless Heidegger's relation to Nazism. The idea being, again, that to Heidegger, although he's usually celebrated as, you know, the one who saw the nihilism of our time, but no, he precisely lacks the apparatus to grasp, conceptualize, whatever you want, the terrifying position of someone like the living dead in Auschwitz. Why? Because, you know, when Heidegger, the way Heideggerians try to save him, they claim, but Heidegger's point precisely is not to celebrate Auschwitz, but to say the horrible thing that was precisely that. Corpses were there, produced in exactly the same way as, I don't know, you produce tables in a furniture factory, or you produce whatever, tomatoes on a field, and so on. But you know what Heidegger is missing here? Of course, it's just another production, but for the henchmen, for death, no? The question is, how did you, if you were on the side of the victim, No, I can guarantee you. Okay, you were not there. Maybe you will be. You never know. I just want. I can guarantee you will not experience yourself as, oh, isn't it nice? I'm nobody. I'm just reduced to like a piece of cabbage produced. No, for that. And this again is, and I here I deeply am on Lacan's side. That again, for Lacan, paradoxically, there is another dimension in cogito, a dimension which precisely names already or is a first step towards this gap between being and logos, language, thinking. And that this is why, again, we should stick to that point. Let me go on now, to the returning to the main topic, but connecting it to what was already said today about Klinemann and so on. I try to think a little bit about how to formulate that difference about between what we, the Troika, the Christian Troika, are tried to say and some. Okay, we'll not go back.
Who is who?
Who is who? Yeah, yeah. Yes. No, seriously. You know, the way Spinoza was mentioned, I was thinking a little bit about it. Like, in what sense, where is then the difference when you can say, as a Spinozian, that, of course, substance doesn't mean an identity. Substance is nothing but the productive force of Klinemann's. Substance only is, in its effect, all these twists up and down and so on. What, I'm not giving this as an argument, just describing the difference. What we, as nonetheless faithful to Hegel's legacy, would have said is that this is not enough, that in order to account for this productivity, it's not enough to play this absolute immanence of the substance to its result. There must be a certain, let me call it naively, archi crack or arche Klinemann within the substance itself, which there must be a deadlock in substance which pushes the substance towards productivity. Let me give you an example, my own. From yesterday, you remember that boring stuff about alternate modernities. For a Spinozian, it would only mean, of course, we have multiple modernities, and, of course, capitalism is not some kind of elevated divine being. Capitalism is just a product-generating force which only exists in all its Klinemannic, how should I put it, versions, as Asian value and capitalism, which is our future. We already have it in Italy, European version. It's called Berlusconi, no, and so on, no? No, but here we should be Hegelians, like Marx was, and say, yes, but the reason we have multiple alternate modernities is that there is a deadlock in this, in capitalism itself, or to put it even in theological terms. And this is the greatness of maybe even Schelling or some of them. This is, I think, what is for me missing, at least in standard Buddhism. No, it's not enough to say there is a void and then out of void all appearances emanate, but like it is as if Buddha didn't see often enough Star Wars, no, where I hate the movie, but at least, you know, what in Star Wars they call the dark side of the Force. This idea that, which you find precisely in subjectivist, but for me this is in a good sense, modern mysticism, starting with Meister Eckhart, but especially Jakob Böhme, this idea that the cause of the evil in the world is a kind of inner madness reversal in God himself. Okay, let's drop theology, but you got my point, that it's not, this is where I don't buy this Spinozian immanentism. No, sometimes we already, substance is not just this, again, unique field which again expresses itself is in the multitude. You must have some inner Klinemann self-blocking reversal in substance itself. Or the problem with which we are all fighting is, of course, how to think this with Hegel. Where does Hegel stand here?